there's been a, for a while, there's been a gentrification moving in and pushing long-time residents out. So how do we curtail that while being inclusive and respectful of those people that want to move into our district, but also respecting those lifelong colonizers that have been here for quite some time and making sure that just because the rent rises, that does not push people out. We make sure people are able to stay in their homes, keep it affordable, bring good paying jobs here, and make sure that our district is a beacon of light and hope for those people that aspire to do more. Thank you. Good evening. My name is Marvin Holland. I've been married 35 years. My lovely wife Carol's here. I have two children. My daughter's here. She's in the back of the room. She's a lawyer.
Yay!
She's been working hard on the campaign. I've been a transit worker for over 25 years. And with that, I've worked my way up to the ranks, and now I'm the political director of the Transport Workers Union. Mm-hmm. Why that's important, I get things done. This past session, I passed two bills in Albany. The Cleaners Assault Bill, which was a bill to protect transit workers, and I also passed the Veterans Buyback Bill, which allows all veterans to buy back pension time in the civil service pension, including women. For the first time, women can buy back pension. I'm a proud resident of Harlem, and I'm gonna earn this victory on February 14th the old-fashioned way. I'm gonna go out and work hard to get your support, so please support me on February 14th, and I won't let you down. Thank you.
I'm Athena Moore, and I'm a candidate for New York City Council District 9. I'm excited, I'm energized, I'm charged to bring hope and a new vibrancy and a new perspective to Harlem. And not only Harlem, but also Upper West Side, Morningside Heights, and East Harlem as well. I stand here before you as a proud parent of an 11-year-old daughter. I'm a single mom. I also came from public housing, where I grew up in the South Bronx, raised by my grandmother, who was a sharecropper, a first-generation college student, and the first to get a master's degree in my family. I also stand on the proud shoulders of my grandfather, a Baptist minister, and the values of hard work and perseverance have been with me since birth. I also stand before you as an advocate for those in community, because I know firsthand, operating a storefront, the first in history for a borough president in New York City on 125th Street for the Honorable Gail Brewer, where I have been working for the last few years on 125th Street. I bring to you a sensitivity, a compassion, and hope, and wisdom for helping the most vulnerable in our community. And I look forward to bringing the legacy of 20 years experience to the community and service. Thank you.
Good evening, Harlem. I'm a son of Harlem. My name is Troy Outlaw. I'm an 80s baby. I was born right up the street at Harlem Hospital. I was born to two wonderful parents, my mother, whom of which is in the audience. And I'm here as a former staffer to the former councilwoman, now current assemblywoman, Inez Dickens, who's sitting in the back. And I feel that I'm the best qualified candidate because I was the one on the ground providing direct services to the constituents, and one of our top issues was housing. And so we have a big housing problem in this city. It's something that needs to be addressed, and it's gonna take all of us together to come up with some real collaborative ideas. And I see the rent's too damn high in the audience, and the rent is too damn high. And we have to fix that. And so I think I'll be the best candidate to work on the issues, and hopefully that you guys would look at me on February 14th as one of the top candidates and be the wind beneath my wings. Thank you.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Good evening, I'm Senator Bill Perkins, and obviously I'm here along with my colleagues seeking your support to become the council person that represents this area. Some of you may know that I've had the privilege of serving not simply in the New York State Senate, but also before then
in the New York City Council. I have a track record. I've passed the L.A.N.T.E. law, a law that we needed very desperately because our children were being poisoned by L.A.N.T.E. and were being crippled by L.A.N.T.E. Educationally, they were being crippled as well. We have fought to improve public schools in our district. We have brought attention to a very unsexy play. Some of you may recall our fight against the rats that were plaguing our community. Some people thought it was a fight that didn't have to be fought by someone who was elected, but in fact, it had to be fought because it was out of proportion to anything that we've ever seen before. And we passed the New York City Living Wage Law and a statewide minimum wage increase. And we've done more as a way of representing this community from the perspective of the City Council as well as from the perspective of the New York State Senate. As we move forward, I'd like to be able to share with you some of what we're going to be doing for the future, and by the same token, how we can do even more from the perspective of the City Council. Thank you very much.
Good evening, my name is Dawn Simmons and I'm running for City Council. I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight on this rainy evening, and I'd like to thank L.A.N.T.E. for having us here today. Well, about myself, my roots run deep in Harlem. I'm fourth generation Harlem. My great-grandmother came here from Georgia to create a children's school on 126th Street and 5th Avenue. So, some of you may know my grandmother had a piano studio on Travers Row, Miss Juanita's piano studio, and my father was a Sunday school teacher at St. Mark's Methodist Church. I also was an educator with the New York City Board of Education in the Bronx and in Harlem. Currently, I work in finance, but over the course of my adult life, I filed medical records, and I was a social worker with the Brooklyn District Attorney's Office, counseling domestic violence victims, as well as HIV-positive New Yorkers. I have a daughter who is 11 years old, and she attends a charter school, and I have lived different places throughout my years. However, no matter where I've gone, nor where I've been, no place is like Harlem. And I am not a politician. I have not worked in a social services setting, except for when I was a social worker. However, living here all of my years, I see how the community has changed. In some ways for the better, in some ways not so good. And a lot of people have been left behind. I'm running because I want to make sure that everyone is getting an equal opportunity to do well here in Harlem. And the other issue, of course, which we're here for,
Thank you very much. Let's talk about housing, and I want to start with the TIL program, the Tenant Interim Lease Program. There are thousands of affordable apartments spread across 156 buildings, many of them here in the 9th Council District. Many of these city-owned buildings have fallen into disrepair. They need additional funding from the city, so that they can convert to low-income co-ops, long-term, permanent, affordable housing. If elected, would you support using funding from the Department of Homeless Services or any other source to stabilize and repair TIL buildings? That's sort of an opening question. Anyone is free, just signal with a hand if you've got something to say about it. We'll start with you, Mr. Cooper.
Thank you. And we're all here because housing is a major issue in the community. I would support such bill, but it's something that I've been working on for the past several years now. I'd like to say recently, working with Community Voices Heard, we've now been able to push the mayor to agree to put over $1 billion into NYCHA housing. $1 billion into NYCHA housing. But it must go even further. We must look at this as an opportunity to create jobs within the district, because I look at myself. The reason I was able to grow and the reason I was able to develop was I had the opportunity and the potential to get a job. A lot of times we have our youth in the community, they can't find a job.
Mr. Cooper, I want to stay focused on TIL. I mean, this is a housing forum, and we want to stay focused not on NYCHA, not on jobs, but on TIL. Let's get some other folks in here. Please, Cleare.
The answer is yes. I think that money should be put into the TIL program. The TIL program is a very beneficial program to our communities. There's vested interest from our tenants who live in those buildings, because in order to be in the TIL program, buildings have said, listen, we've had all these repairs, we've been all these violations, we've been in disrepair, the building's not functioning properly. We want to run the building. We want to bring it back. And I think this is one of the most important and wonderful things that we can do. And money should go into those buildings to support people who've been committed to our community and who want to take on that kind of a responsibility and create affordable home ownership opportunities for others. But the answer is yes, yes.
Ms. Alves and then Ms. Dawn.
Thank you.
I think TIL is a very beneficial program, and I think it'll benefit the entire society if we allow tenants to have home ownership, self-sufficiency, in which case empower them, and it would benefit, that would resonate throughout the whole society. So I think that's a great program that should be supported, and I'd support it.
Okay, let's get Bill Perkins wanted to jump in on this.
Can I speak a little louder?
Yeah.
Began during my tenure as a member of the city council, and it was one of the landmark pieces of the administration that truly represented affordability. Very often, when we're talking about affordable housing, we're not talking about what's in the pockets of the people that supposedly the housing is for. And during that period, we had a great challenge, because we kept hearing about affordability and affordable housing, but the community people that we represented were not being given the kind of rent opportunities that met the needs of their pocket. Toward that end, my office was very instrumental in making sure that this TIL program was a program that was representative of the needs of the people in the neighborhood. And I have to say, with all due respect, Cordell Cleare, who's amongst us today, shared in that opportunity to make that happen. So I was very fortunate that my office at that time as a city council person was able to take some leadership, not only for the Harlem community, but even outside of the Harlem community, where this program was beginning to be implemented. And it, not only was it affordable, but it ultimately had an opportunity for people to own their particular home. And that was very significant to us. Thank you for asking that question.
What now? I mean, there are vacant units, there are buildings that are falling into disrepair.
The city obviously has a history of being able to adequately and almost in a visionary way address that problem as the TIL program was originally. And I think that we need to go back to that type of thinking and back to that type of policy, so that kind of affordability as well as quality and ownership opportunity can be made available for the people in the community that need it. Instead, what has happened, I want to just qualify this by mentioning one other thing. We have moved away from that, and we have turned Harlem into something that is unaffordable and that is purely a matter of the market. Mm-hmm. And as a result, there's a lot of tension in the neighborhood, there's a lot of concern in the neighborhood that those who have paid their dues to be in the neighborhood are not going to be able to afford to live in this neighborhood. So we're going to make sure that doesn't continue.
Okay, Mr. Holland and Mr. Holland, thank you.
Currently, there are 2,422 apartments inside of the TIL program. About 1,500 of those are actually have occupants, and about 900 are vacant. So what we've done is we've looked at this program very closely at my team and said that we would create a housing legacy program for Harlem. It works in two ways. One, because there's about a little over half of the people that are living in these buildings are already in these buildings, we need to make sure that we can keep them there. And then the second thing is to what do we do with the 900 vacant apartments that are part of the TIL program currently as we speak. What we would do is create a housing legacy program. If you've lived in Harlem 10, 15, 20 years, either have a vocational or college degree, and you've come back and you can't find a place to live in Harlem, they would be perfect to be as part of this TIL program. The original TIL program was only supposed to cost you $250 to own your apartment, but it hasn't worked out that way. So whoever's the next council person here, or when I'm the next council person here, I will demand that the mayor put money into the TIL program and stop fooling around. You shouldn't have to ask for this. This should be done already. I will demand that the mayor put the money into the TIL program. Thank you.
Well, to build on what the senator said, I was in the city council as a staffer, as a deputy chief of staff working in Bronx council member's office. And it was a great program and helped ownership, but right now it's fallen by the wayside. I know that there's conversations going through the city council now to figure out ways that we can build on that, but we have to hold the mayor's feet to the fire and make sure that he puts the money into this program so that our community residents aren't being pushed out of their houses. And I know that firsthand experience, I've dealt with, you know, crying mothers that have children and they're worried about being put out, and they thought they were buying something that they were buying into as an ownership, but it seems to not be that case. So we definitely have to, yes, put in the money.
And Mr. Fields.
I believe that we need to call on a greater investment for the TIL program.
I believe that we need to call on a greater investment for the TIL program, make sure that we hold our elected officials and those that represent us in our interests accountable for the neglectfulness of the program under the years and how it has fallen to the waste of. And not only that, if we're going to use funds and money from the Department of Homeless Services, then we've got to make sure that that money is being invested correctly and properly. And we need to build onto the program to add certain supports there so that we do not be here in another 10 to 15 years where we have an influx of flow of cash into this program and then eyes divert elsewhere to other matters, and then we back here saying that the program is falling, it's faulty, it's broken, and we're figuring out how do we start again and rebuilding this program. And if we're going to use the money, we got to make sure that we have a huge homelessness problem. Not only just an affordable housing issue, but we have a homeless crisis as well. So if we're going to use money from the Department of Homeless Services, then we got to make sure that those people that are suffering that by the homelessness have a pathway to ownership of their own homes as well.
Okay. I want to, was there someone else who wanted to get on this?
Yeah, I was just briefly just interjecting that I agree, yes, I would support the program's continuation with the use of money from homeless and services and ensure to incorporate those who are currently homeless into those units to ensure that they have affordability, to ensure that they have a shelter where they didn't have shelter before, and to ensure that there's a mix of financing so that we could ensure the preservation of the program and to expand on the program, not just have it remain where it is.
I do want to say a special hello to former council member Inez Dickens.
Boo!
I'm burning into my back. I want to make sure I'm careful. Okay, we blew my cover. Good. I just want to close out that question by pointing out, Eleanor just found this, that the director of the tenant interim lease program is vacant. The job listing went up on January 13th, so there's a lot of work to be done there.
All right, for our next question, under the rights to council bill 214A, the city would provide lawyers for tenants at risk of eviction as limited to New York as earning less than twice the federal poverty line in New York City. That means an individual making below $44,000. Should the program be expanded to include more middle-class tenants? I will open it up to everyone.
I believe, yes, the program needs to be expanded. I think the poverty line, or what we consider poverty, is primarily subjective. I don't know, but I don't believe that anybody, whether it's 44,000, 15,000, 10,000, it's very hard to live in this district as it's currently constructed, making 40,000 to 50,000, 60,000. I think we need to open and expand the program, look at ways on how we can better assist people trying to stay in their homes, but also trying to seek out new revenue costs to make sure that we fix current buildings that need to be fixed here.
I agree. I'm sorry. I agree.
major issue that our office at the Manhattan Borough President Office on a day-to-day basis with constituents, helping them to prevent eviction and to make sure that they had adequate representation. And we are seeing that there's a gap, that even those who are both at the moderate income levels as well as the middle class income levels are being squeezed more and more. It's not just those who are at the lowest rungs. And so I think the program needs to be expanded and definitely more supports for legal services.
Yes, I agree. The program should be expanded. 90% of tenants go into court unrepresented. 90% of landlords go in represented. People lose court cases and are displaced and evicted from their homes simply because they don't know the law. They don't know their rights. And this is happening on all levels. $50,000, $40,000 a year salary is almost poverty when you look at the cost of living. After you doled out $24,000 a year in rent and have one or two children, you are really in poverty. And sometimes people hesitate to even go to court and bring these complaints against tenants, because they don't feel like they're going to be able to represent themselves, and they don't want to take days off from work, losing more money to go represent themselves. So oftentimes they agree to things that are not good for them. Yes, I think that we should do everything we can to represent people who are going to court, who are in there or attend court.
And I think that's a great answer. And I think most of us here on the panel we're all gonna agree that this is needed, expanded. This should not even be a question at all. But I think we need to move further on. We need to look at the economics that's happening in Harlem here. Within the next 5 years, there's about $7 billion worth of economic development that's gonna happen in Harlem. We need to ask ourselves, how can minority and women-owned businesses take advantage of this economic opportunity that will take place in Harlem?
We're talking about representation, and we should stay on the topic of representation.
I agree, and I agree, but I think most of us would agree that it needs to be expanded.
Okay, this is a little bit of a sensitive topic for me because I understand what it's like to have poor legal representation. I actually did a study called an analysis of the perceptions of consumers of legal services in Manhattan, New York, dissatisfied consumers of legal services. It was an interpretive phenomenological analysis, and it looked at what happens when people don't get properly represented by lawyers. So even if we have a program where we're providing legal representation, there needs to be strict oversight in that representation to make sure that they are getting what they need. We also asked if it should be expanded to middle class and or upper middle class, stuff like that, and I said yes, because where I am, in a privately owned co-op, we have lots of disputes and we seem to attract lawyers left and right in my particular co-op, and once we have a dispute and we end up with a lawyer, we never get out of court because it seems like a free-for-all. There's no oversight, we're privately owned, and it becomes a free-for-all. So in any case, even when people have legal forums and things like that, they bring lawyers to the neighborhood, I'm always careful with making sure that they're accountable for the information that's disseminated to the constituents of the area. And when you're giving people access to our constituents, we have to make sure that there's oversight and regulation of those people. So, Ms. Bravo.
I think that we should definitely expand the program to middle-income families, as well as more so getting the word out to more low-income families that know that this program exists. And I want to commend the work that L.A.N.T.E. Harlem does. You can give them a round of applause because they should be poverty in their homes more so than some of these participants that participate in that program. So I just want to commend them on their work.
Yes, I agree that we should kind of expand legal services to those who are middle income. Because what is middle income? There are times when people have problems in their homes, or there's money that has to be spent elsewhere, and they can't afford a lawyer. In my own case, my father, they were trying to push him out of his apartment, and they spent hundreds or thousands of dollars to have a lawyer just to keep him in his own home because they wanted the apartment for themselves. So yes, I agree. We do need
to expand the program for not just low income, but for middle income and upper middle income as well. Thank you.
Absolutely, the program is just being expanded. One of the things I've done as political director of the Transport Working Committee in the last 3 years was help organize Palante's annual workshop with Rights to Know. And so we did over 300 workshops the last 3 years. And the purpose of sponsoring that was so residents would know their rights. And so this law definitely needs to be expanded to include more people. I just want to take a brief moment to essentially agree, obviously, with my colleagues, all of whom are basically saying the same thing. I think, however, that this is a big challenge because we're moving towards another segment of our community that is experiencing the same thing that lower income families have been experiencing. Many of our working families are going through the same challenges and changes. And so we need to put through the city council a pool of funds that will make it more available for them to get that kind of support. I'm interested in developing that. If any of you have some proposals of a particular type that you think hit the mark, by all means, don't hesitate to let us know. But it's clear that the challenges of living in New York City for the middle income are almost as challenging as they may be for those of lesser income. And we want to make sure that those income strata are taken care of.
You know, I'm going to continue on with a similar kind of a question.